lecture slides and start the lecture. I'm actually going to do that from here itself. So are you? Is everybody here on the nuts and bolts section? Mm-hmm. Right here is the PowerPoint. I'm just going to download it from here. And then... Is it intro programming? So, this is just basically, you know, from this Bash and Terminal. Everybody's familiar with Bash and Terminal, right? Now, nobody has any sort of doubts in terms of, you know, this part. Just adding stuff to your Bash profile or working with the terminal. That section is almost over. We're gonna come back to it a little bit in the end, maybe. But other than that, we're moving on now to the new section with R and programming. So that's the downstream part. We covered HTSeq and how to make counts and everything. Yes, last on Friday. So essentially that ends with your, you know, getting the counts for each sample. And then we import everything into R, and then the downstream analysis is done in R. Okay? So if you have any doubts in that part, you know, we can always bring it up with me. But for that, we'll just start with R programming today. Okay? So R is a high-level programming environment for statistics and for data analysis. It's open source. That's actually one of the big things about R is that, you know, it's the way it's designed is that it was created by people like you and me. It's just very much based on the sharing environment. So the sharing movement where we don't hold on to stuff. We tend to, you know, make stuff in R. Everything written is freely available. All the code, all the packages are all free in R. It's actually an implementation of the S language. So nobody knows, but before R, there was S. So, I know. They were very, very, you know, good with naming, so they figured, you know, S is original, let's come up with something better, R. So designed to enable sophisticated statistical analysis without having to do coding in C and Perl. So it was designed by statisticians for their for making things easier so that you don't have to learn comprehensive and difficult programming in C. So that's actually one of the good reasons for learning R is that it takes you one level higher. It's a high level language. You don't have to program in C. It has a lot of stuff, including statistics, machine learning functions. You can use it in finance. It has financial packages as well. It has bioinformatics packages. Bioconductor is a whole different side to R. And it has a great graphical engine to visualize data, which some of you have already used some of it, so would realize how powerful R is. Most of the graphics that you get in publications, quite a few of them come from being made in R. You can write scripts in it. It implements data structures and has advanced input-output. Now we'll be going over, you're familiar with scripts now, right? You get the idea of what a script is? Pretty much, no? A little confusion? Okay, so scripts are essentially, you know, you call any sequence of lines written together that perform a certain function in a programming language as a script. So it's a small program that's called a script. All right? So you can do that in R as well. We'll talk a little bit about data structures as we go along. So as the name suggests, data structure, it's a way to organize data in your program. So when you write a program, most of the times you end up either creating new data or you end up using existing data. In our case, for example, we will be using R to import data in files or as a matrix that we have stored. So remember the counts that we created, right? So that counts are imported. So that count by itself, a row of those counts or a column of those counts for a sample, that is a data structure. We can store it in a data structure. So you create a structure called a vector, and you store that data in that vector. Or you could create a matrix and store an entire table in a matrix instead of one column. right? So those are data structures. Data structures are essentially placeholders for your data. Okay, does that make sense? Now, R has powerful ways to implement these data structures to make them fast, to make them more efficient, so that you can perform functions on that data structure. And also you can read in from files directly. So say you have an Excel file with your data in it, you can read that Excel file, import it directly into R. Okay? Now, so think of it as something in between Excel and programming. So it's not as advanced as programming, where you know you have complete control on the memory and everything, and you can do a lot more with C programming for sure. But in Excel, there are these limitations and there's not so much freedom. So R gives you extra freedom, it gives you more options than Excel, but it's a slightly less than the stage where you can independently think of it as a programming language, right? So we'll go over all that. Now, anything in R, so this is a term that we'll be using and going over more in detail as we go along. What is objects? Okay, so objects, if we go deep into what objects are, it'll take an entire course. We can just talk about classes and objects and what they are, and there's this whole paradigm of object-oriented programming. But let's, before we go too much into objects, let's first just quickly go over these classes of objects. So think of a class as a blueprint. That's the way I have learned classes to be. Initially, it's a little challenging to understand this concept, but if you think of it as a blueprint for to start with and then go from there, it becomes slightly easier. For example, whenever you're designing a house, right, what does the architect do? He creates a blueprint, right? That blueprint contains what? It contains the layout of the house. It contains what the room's dimensions will be. It contains whether it'll have a kitchen, where the kitchen will be located, whether each of the kitchen has, would it have space for the cooking range, the fridge. All of those things are laid out in the blueprint, right? Right? But it does not actually mean that once you've created a blueprint, that does not mean that it's a house. Right? If he handed you just the blueprint and be like, here you go, give me $450,000, you'll be like, no, where is the house you promised me? Right? This is just a blueprint. Exactly like that. Classes are blueprints for objects. They contain information about the objects that are going to come later, but they don't essentially mean that they are the object itself. Okay? So far, the difference between class and object, does that make sense or no? If, without regards to programming, just the simple concept of what an object is and what a class is. Right? If the house was an object, then the architecture created blueprint of that house would be the class. Does that make sense or no? Yeah? Everybody on board so far? Okay, great. So, next. Now, if we have to go on that model, think of R as four atomic classes of objects. So, by that we mean that think of these as the basic building blocks of R. Or the data that we get in R is based on these five basic types of data can be imported in R, including character. So these can be character. The data can be of the character class or character type, right? So characters are A, B, C, D, all of those are characters. Numeric or real numbers, integers, which are different from real numbers. Does anybody know the difference between integers and real numbers? Let's say it out loud. Okay.
No decimal.
No decimal places, yeah. Exactly. So integers are essentially numbers that are without a decimal place. And real numbers include integers as well, just to clarify. Complex, anything that has an imaginary part. So you know, square root of minus one is a complex I that we denote, right? That's the notation that was created. So you can have complex numbers in R. And then you have the logical. Now, logical is a class which is very important. It is used throughout in programming because a lot of programming depends on whether something, the outcome of a statement would, is either a logical yes or a logical no, either true or a false. Okay? So far you're with me.
So what about if you have
an integer combination with a character, how do you, does that?
Like so if, it, if it's a 1C, mm-hmm. for example, then that would then be become a character. Because it'll become, you know, it'll be on the type of a character, or a, then it actually goes to the next stage, which is a string. It's no longer a character. It's made out of two characters. But characters can also include integer characters. Like one is also a character when it is represented off the type character class. But one can be represented as an integer when it is of integer type. So in a program, you can define whether you want, you're typing an address where you want one as a character, so I live on street number one, versus I one is a off type, a mathematical one, where I'm trying to add it to another integer or another real number. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay.
So
all right.
This is kind of like Excel, where you can change the format
yes,
of the cell
exactly.
to a number, an
yes.
integer. Like
yes. So in Excel, that's exactly exactly right. So. Remember how sometimes when you have the gene set 9, it changes just to 9 September?
Yeah.
That's because the date is the type of class that it automatically assigns anything with that to. It is very annoying and frustrating, I know, but you have to change that format of that back to not being a date, but being a string. And so those type, that format, that string or date, those are essentially the type or the class of that particular object. So the object would be Sep 9 as a, either a string or September 9th as a date. So the object is Sep 9 itself, but the class is either date or string. Does that make sense? Still on board? Okay. So now in R, we have talked about these atomic classes, but there now let's go over to an object, which is the most basic object in R. This object is called a vector, right? Think of a vector as nothing more than a collection of objects, all right? So a collection, these objects could be of the class character, they could be of the class numeric, this could be, these objects could be integers. So when I'm saying objects, I actually just mean, you know, instances of the type integer. So numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 to 10, they are 10 objects. 1, 2, 3, 4, 10. These are 10 of the type, and I can choose them their type to be integer. I can choose their type to be character. So let's say by default I choose their type to be integer, and I put them all together, and I assign this entire group or entire collection to something. That something is a vector. Okay? So I've put these all together in one group, one bunch, lined them up. Let's say I have 10 of these objects in a line. This will form a vector. Okay. Now, a vector has one specific property. It can only contain objects of the same class. This will hold true throughout in R. When you have a vector, you cannot have one object in it as the integer one and another next object in it as a string one. It'll give you an error, or it'll automatically convert one to the other to maintain its integrity. Now, one exception of a class of that is a list, which is represented as a vector but can contain objects of different classes. Indeed, that's usually why we use them. So, now, there were people who said, well, programmers mostly, who said, well, what if we need this. We need to have a vector that can contain not only one type, but something else. Like, all right, let's create this new class or new data type called list, which is essentially a vector, but it has the property that it can have one additional or multiple different types of objects. Okay? So a vector which can contain multiple types of objects is a list. All right? So this is all nomenclature. We're just going to go over the details of what it is. And if you are unfamiliar with the nomenclature, it'll become more clear as we work through it in the examples in our practical. Okay? But if you're still, you have doubts, ask now. So far, everything good on this slide?
Well, if the vector contains objects of the same class,
yes.
How can the most basic object be a vector?
How can what?
The most basic object be a vector.
What do you mean?
You said the most basic
Yeah, the most basic object is a vector. So you can have that.
I agree that doesn't make sense to me, but I just kind of think that everything else makes sense, so
yeah.
I'm not paying attention to that.
Yeah, exactly. If I forget that, then everything makes sense to me.
So a vector can contain other vectors of the same type. So you can have a meta vector, which can contain a vector of other types. You can combine different vectors and create one vector.
Okay.
So a vector is an object that's just like a box of other objects?
Yes.
So it's like a recursive kind of
thing? Recursive kind of thing. So there is something in programming called recursive, which means that you're able to call yourself. So it's an unfamiliar concept in general, but if you try to wrap your head around it, you can think of it as, there has to be an analogy somewhere. It's like the chicken and egg, right? Which came first, the chicken or the egg? But if the chicken is the egg, then you know it can call itself the chicken. So that way, the problem is solved. Technically, theoretically, there is no chicken. There is just the egg, or there was never an egg. It's just the chicken. Whichever way you define as the basic object, everything else just means that it can contain itself. All right. So the most basic object is a vector, but that vector can contain other objects, including itself. All right? So, okay. We can go over a philosophical discussion later. I know it's very mind-bending, you know? So, empty vectors can be created with the vector function. Now, this function, anything with these brackets is essentially a function, these curly brackets. But the vector function is a user is not user defined. It's something that is available to us by the compiler. It's part of the syntax of the programming, which means that when you call this function, a specific things happen. It's not that you are not defining this function, it's made available to you. So certain functions can be defined by you, certain functions are available to you. We'll go over functions in detail, a lot more detail in the coming lectures, but for now, empty vector, if you want to create one, you can use this particular syntax to create a vector. If you don't put anything in it, it'll create a vector for you. We'll go over that in the practical. Now, moving on. Numbers. So numbers in R are generally treated as numeric objects. That is, they are double precision real numbers. The precision part you can ignore for now. We'll just go over that later. But think of them as just numbers are real numbers, and they are basically of the type numeric, the one that we discussed earlier, the numeric class. Okay? And if you explicitly want an integer, you need to specify the L suffix after something. So one, entering 1 gives you a numeric object. Entering 1L explicitly gives you an integer. That's just the way to distinguish something. So they had to assign some default, right? I mean, by default, if you just put 1 there, it'll be considered a numeric by default. But if you add an L, the character L in front of it, then it becomes an integer. And it's only the L character that makes it an integer. You can't put 1C and expect that to be an integer. Okay? All right. So for those people who are having a little bit of doubt, speak. No? No
if
doubts?
You, if you write 123L, is it?
It's going to be 123.
123.
Okay. The integer 123. Okay. So there is also a special number called INF, which represents infinity. For example, 1 divided by 0, IN is infinity. Right? Anything divided by 0 is infinity. INF can be used in ordinary calculation. Example, 1 divided by infinity is 0. So it actually means something. It isn't just the characters INF. INF translates to infinity. Okay? This becomes more and more useful as you go and learn deeper things, right? If you go deeper in R, you know, like basically in order to simplify programming, so like if you earlier, we had mechanical calculators, right? They were literally based on gears and mechanics. So if you divide 1 by 0, it essentially subtracts 0 from 1 infinite times, because that's what it needs to do. So it'll just not stop going. The gears of the calculator will keep moving, because that essentially is division, is repeated subtraction, right? If you go in mathematics, what is division? When you say 20 divided by 5, it essentially means subtract 5 from 20 as many times until you get a remainder which cannot be subtracted. So for example, 20 minus 5 is 15, 15 minus 5 is 10, 10 minus 5 is 5, 5 minus 5 is 0. When you get there, 4 times you have done this operation, that becomes your dividend. Sorry, that becomes your dividend divisor, remainder, quotient. Right? So, quotient, that's the answer, 4. So, but that essentially means that you're dividing it 4 times, but subtracting it 4 times. And when you divide 1 by 0, you have to keep subtracting 0 until you get 0, which will happen never, right? So that's why, in order to simplify it for the computer, they named this operation 1 divided by 0 as INF infinity, so that you don't go into an error. Okay, the value NAM represents an undefined value, not a number. Notice that it's different from infinity. 0 by 0 is not a number, because that's not infinity. 0 divided by 0 does not mean anything. It's not a number, which is different from infinity. So they named it separately as NAM. Okay? NAM can also be thought as a missing value. More on that later. Okay? All right? So, attributes. Our objects can have attributes. For example, any R object will have name. They will have dim names, dimensions, class, length, other user-defined attributes and metadata. For example, let's create a vector which contains numbers, or even the very basic integer object like 1L. If you create something, it will still have a name. It will still have a class. Supposing you want to know what that is, you can always type class of that, and it'll give you the actual class. So for example, class of 1L will give you the answer integer. Class of just 1 by default will give you the answer numeric. All right. So think of these attributes as a way to find out more about something. So if you put those length of some in variable that contains a vector, will give you the actual length of that. Like, so say you create a vector which has 5 objects in it, and you call length on that vector, it'll tell you that it contains 5. It'll give you 5 as the answer, because that's how many objects the vector contains. Okay. Attributes of the can be accessed using the attribute function. So while these are the attributes that may be available for your object, if you want to find out what attributes are there for your object, you can use the attribute function, and then you know what attributes are available, which you can then call on your object to find out more about that. Yes.
So you have RNA-seq data, you have FPKM, and you have a gene name.
Yes.
The FPKM value is an object. Could you assign the gene name as an attribute?
Yes.
Yes? Okay.
So the row names could be your gene names vector. So let's say you create a vector of gene names, and you have a vector of your column names, which are your samples.
Yeah.
Right? So those are strings. You put them based on the samples. You create another vector with your gene names. Now, let's say you import, somehow you manage to import and create a matrix which contains your genes, which contains all the samples. Now, the next thing you want to tell is, okay, the row names for this matrix is essentially the genes, right? Because that's what the matrix is. Each column is your sample, and each row is your gene, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you could just say row names. Let's call this matrix as M. Try to be original. So matrix M is there. You've created that. Now you can say row names of M is equal to gene names vector. Column names of M is equal to vector sample names vector. And then that matrix automatically gets labeled like that. And then if you print that matrix, it'll have the column names as your samples and the row names as that. And so these column names and row names are essentially your attributes for your matrix.
Is dim names like the union of row names and column names?
Yes. It's
okay.
Basically the, we'll go over all of this. So names, dim names, they're all basically attributes, column names, row names, and some of these are by default. Dimensions is the actual dimension of the matrix. So you want to, or dimensions of the array, you want to find out how big your matrix is. Is it 30,000 by 10? So 30,000 rows with 10 columns, or the other way around. Okay? If you just have a vector, then you want to find out the length of that vector, stuff like that. Well, like I said, we'll be, you know, going this. So now it gets interesting. So this slide is your first slide of understanding how to create something with data. So let's say you have, you know, two numbers, 0.5 and 0.6. Remember we talked about creating vectors out of them? Is a C function, C, just C with two brackets, curly brackets, the simple brackets, is a function that is used to create vectors. You can also use a vector function, which can be used like this, and you can assign other stuff to it as well, but you can all, but that's a little longer, so there's a shortcut version where you just use C. Simple. C in round brackets, and you put whatever you want in it. So if you want to create a numeric logical vector, just put true and false in it. You can also use T and F instead of true and false, just as a shortcut. You can also create, so characters. Now notice characters have codes. So those codes are important. You can try creating without them and see what happens. And then integers, you can also create from, for here, so 9:29. So colon in the middle says 9:29. So it goes 9, 10, 11, 12, boom, 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 till 29.
Is if you wanted to do like every other, it's colon, 2::
We'll go over that in a second.
Okay.
That's a good question. So this is a complex one, 1 plus 0i, 2 plus 4i. You can just put this and it'll create a complex vector for you. Right? So these are just simple ways of creating a vector. We'll be doing a lot of this in the practical, so don't worry too much. The vector function itself can be used to create empty vectors containing 0 by default. So you specify the class. Numeric, you specify the length, so 10 is the number of, and by default it just puts 0. Okay, moving on. So what about the following? What do you think happens here? Remember I told you that you could technically try to put two different kinds in a vector? So will it give you an error?
It'll make it into a list, right?
Well, do you think what will happen? Will it make it into a list? Will it give you an error? So when you use the C function, you're essentially saying that I want this as a vector.
Okay.
So one option is that it could give you an error, saying that there are two things of a different kind. But R is robust enough not to just do that by default. What it does is it tries to convert one to the other. So it'll just try and see whether it can convert 1.7 into character or A into numeric. So if I was R as a compiler, I think converting A into numeric would be a little harder than going 1.7 into character. Because if all I have to do to convert 1.7 into character is just put quotes around it. Yes.
Does it matter if, so do they have to be double quotes? Do single quote?
They could be the single quote as well.
Okay.
They still represent characters. So let's see, so this is called, when something is converted to another, it's called coercion. So for example, one of these two will either be converted into numeric or to the logical type. If I was R, I don't know what the logical type for 2 would be, because 0 and 1, yes, makes sense, but 2 is outside my range. I would technically just convert true into 1 or 0, whichever is a logical symbol, or whichever is a numeric representation of that, and then I'll be done, right? So that would be one way. Same thing with this. If it's a character, I just put quotes around here and make it into a true as a character string.
Generally, you're saying, though, not to do that. That's not a good thing to be coercing.
No. Why would you want to do that, right? I mean,
lazy.
Yes. So essentially, it does it for you if you do something like this. But if most of the times you will never use this, most of the times you just know what the vector is in before you even create a vector. So explicit coercion. Objects can also be explicitly coerced from one class to another using this dot star functions if available. For example. As dot function, so as dot star function, so as dot numeric, as dot logical, as dot character. So supposing I explicitly want to convert integer to numeric. So let's say x is made as a vector from 0 to 6, so 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's our vector. Now, by default, the class of x, remember we were talking about attributes and how to call the attributes for that class? So class is one of the attributes that you can call to find out what is the default class right now for this particular object. So even before we go to this step, does everybody understand what is happening in this statement? So let me just go over this so that you kind of get a sense of what is happening. whenever we want to create something or data type or anything in R, there has to be, so any sort of words that, for example, I could use X here, but it would be not wise of me to use integer as the name of the variable that I'm trying to create. Because then that creates confusion as to whether it's the actual integer class I'm calling, or is it the name of the vector that I'm trying to call, as which I'll be storing integers in, right? Or for that same reasoning, you shouldn't use a variable name as matrix or as data frame or complex or true. you could technically use those, they'll not give you an error, but it's just not good programming practice. So first thing we did is we create this as our variable, which we just called it x. Now we have to put something in that variable, right? We're creating a vector. This is our vector name. Next thing we do is we use this symbol. This is, in R, is an alternative to using equal to. So this sign less than and dash means equal to. You can also use equal to. You don't have to use this particular symbol in R. All right? So then what's happening here? You have x less than dash 0 to 6. Now, what's basically, if we just think of this as an assignment or equal to, it's saying that x will be assigned to the result of what this expression translates to. Take a second to let that sink in. If you want to look at the other way around, ignore this. It says evaluate this 0:6 and then assign it to x.
Once that's assigned, is it sort of saved as a file, or is it like sort of like when when you log out, it goes away, sort of like on a command prompt?
Right. So assignment basically. There's a deeper meaning to it. So now we're going into philosophy and actually what happens inside a computer's head, what's going on in the memory. So when you say this is to be not taken lightly. This statement essentially translates to telling the compiler or interpreter that now you will have these things coming in. Be prepared to create space for that in your memory. That's essentially what it's saying. And based on what type is this, whether it's a number, which is why where it's important now whether to see whether it's a numeric or an integer or it's logical or it's character. Why make all these distinctions? You could essentially just create numeric and it could contain integer and it could contain logical, right? The distinction is also to save space. For example, you only need a certain amount of space for integers. You know, a certain, say, 8 bits can be used to store an integer. Whereas for a real number, you have to allocate more space because they contain decimal points and further things down the line for that. So when you're saying this, by default, I'm going to create an integer vector, it's a different space in the memory that has to be reserved for this vector as opposed to saying this as a character or this as a logical. And that's why you have this assignment statement. It's saying that, okay, this is an integer, reserve for each number, reserve 8 bytes in your memory. And that's what's happening.
Is it automatically understood that it's create?
Yes.
So is
this assignment is what does in the back end. It goes, the compiler reserves certain space in the memory. So a block of space, let's say bytes, say 8 bytes are, so how many? 0 to 6, that's 7. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7 times, let's say 8 bytes. So 7, 8 are 56 bytes of contiguous space is assigned in the memory, and then that location of that is assigned to the variable x in the backend. So x, in essence, contains the location where this space has been allocated.
Is that the same thing as saying create 0 to 6? Earlier, the previous slide, you were showing the create.
Oh, yeah, that was the next question. C in parentheses.
Yes.
You don't need that for integers.
No, it's the same thing.
Okay.
So what does this mean? 0:6. That means
0 to 6.
Create a vector.
Create a vector
of integers that are 0 to 6.
Yes.
Okay.
So R is a little dense in that sense that it compacts a lot of stuff. And our programmers take pride in compacting things. So as we go along, you will see there'll be one line of code which translates to literally 10 or 20 lines of actual meaning of that code.
So you could have written it two different ways. This
yes.
way, or three different ways, with the equal sign, and then the third way was with the C.
You could also write it with the vector function, the vector,
oh, so that's
four different ways.
Okay.
So there are multiple ways to do the same exact thing. My advice, use the simplest and the stuff that you will, and most people will understand. So if I was to create a vector, I will use the C, colon, and this, and put the brackets, and put 0:6. Just because it makes things simpler. Yes.
So 0 to 6, so those values may not be in the same column or same row. They could be distributed all over the matrix.
Are you talking about the memory or are you talking
no,
about...
No, I'm defining
no,
the
this is not a matrix, this is a vector.
So
a vector is just one single unidimensional data structure. Matrices will come later and they are combinations or of vectors. They're multiple vectors put together. So vector is only one dimension. Does that make sense?
Is a vector traditionally a column, considered a column, or considered a row? It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
Because you might have.
It doesn't have the column or row, so that is in your mind.
But if you were adding them together.
So you can add them row wise or column wise when you create a matrix.
You have to define them.
You have to define that when you. There is a default option.
A
we'll
default
go over.
Is...
Default is when we cover matrices. We'll talk about that. Okay, so I really thought it would be a lot further, but okay. Nonsensical coercion results in NAs. For example, if you try to make these characters as numeric, they'll give you NA. NA means not applicable, I don't know what you're talking about, whatever you want to call it. Right? Because A, B, C as characters, if you try to convert them into numeric, it's just not possible. So it just tells you NA. I don't know what you're talking about. That's what it's saying. NA is introduced by coercion as dot logical x, again the same thing, A, B, C, to convert them into true and false, there's doesn't mean anything. Okay? So, lists. So lists are a special type of vector that can contain elements of different classes. Lists are very important data type in R and you should get to know them well. So just like vectors, they have a way to create them. They don't have a shortcut, you use the list function like that. Right? Instead of, so you could have had the vector function here, and then attributes within that. So here, a list, since it contains different kinds of data, it doesn't have to be just one kind, you create them with 1a, true, 4, 1 plus 4i. So these are all, you know, integer, character, logical, and complex. So they're all stored in these sub-values. So the first element is 1, the second element is a, the third element is true, the fourth is likewise. Okay? So matrices. Matrices are vectors with a dimension attribute. So we were talking about matrices. And so matrices are vectors with dimension attributes. The dimension attribute itself is an integer vector of length 2, row and column. Do you understand that? Take that, let it sink in for a second. So matrices are vectors with dimension attribute. Okay, so it's a combination of vector. Depending on the dimension, whether it's 3 rows and 2 columns or 2 rows and 3 columns, you can have a vector of length 6 translate into, and it'll be stored as a vector, but it essentially is displayed as a matrix. That can be happening in the back end, right? Because the memory could be just in the memory, it's stored as a long vector. But you have defined it to have a dimension of 3, 2, which means 3 rows, 2 columns. So it's even if it is stored contiguously, when you type out the name of the matrix, it'll show you as 3 rows containing 2 columns. Does that make sense?
Can you have multiple dimensions, like 3, 4 dimensions, or is it just 2-dimensional?
Matrices tend to be 2-dimensional. For that, you'll have to create a new data structure. And I'm sure there exists something. So for example, matrix M with number of rows 2, columns is equal to 3. You can create that by default. It will not be populated with anything. It'll just have NAs, but that's how it's displayed. But if you type the dimension of M, it'll tell you 2, 3. 2 rows, 3 columns. First one is the row, second one is the column. And if you type attributes, it'll tell you that there is a dimension and that the value of that dimension vector is 2, 3.
I can see where you'd want 3, though, if you wanted a data cube, not just a 2-dimensional structure, but a 3D.
Yeah.
And and then you would have end row and column comma.
Yeah, you'll have a third one.
And what's the third one called?
Call it anything.
You can so
you can create the name for that attribute.
Oh, so the end row and end column are not reserved names.
No, end row and end column are, but then the third one you can add. End space. N Y N Z.
And you would write that in the matrix.
You can create your so when you it will not be a matrix. It won't be called a matrix. You will create your own special data structure or data type or class, which will include a combination of matrices. So it'll all be like you know N. So each of those structures within that structure that you're creating will be a matrix, right? Because that's
for
what
you're two dimensions.
Huh?
It would be a
for three dimensions.
No, I know, but for to create a three-dimensional, you have to create other matrices that are two-dimensional,
yes.
All encompassed within a higher-level
yes.
matrix.
Yes.
Which is three.
Well, that wouldn't be a matrix. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
that,
it would
that
be,
would be a cube. Let's
yeah.
say it's a cube.
Yeah.
Let's call it a cube. So that cube will contain multiple matrices. Okay. So, now, matrices are constructed. Here's your answer, column-wise, by default. So entries can be thought of as starting at the upper left corner and running down the columns. So let's say you have a vector 1, colon 6. Number of rows is equal to 2. Number of columns is equal to 3. This is how they're constructed. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, column-wise, by default. They're not row-wise, column-wise. OK. Matrices can also be created directly from vectors by adding the dimension attributes. So essentially, as I was saying, if you just add a dimension to M, it no longer remains a vector. It gets transferred into a matrix class. You change its class by adding dimension. Because vectors don't have dimensions, they have length. Okay? This, initially, M was a vector of length 10. Then we added, changed this dimension of M, we added the dimension attribute by adding the vector 2, 5, meaning that there are 2 rows and 5 columns. And now M has become a matrix. Okay? So that's one way of creating a matrix. Okay, so interesting part of matrices. There's something called a C binding and R binding, where the C stands for. There you go. And R stands for? There you go, everyone's still awake. So we have matrices that can be created by either column binding or row binding vectors. What are you binding? You're basically binding a vector to either an existing matrix or creating a new matrix by binding columns together. Or binding rows if you're using R bind. Sorry, binding vectors together.
Concatenation.
Appending next to each other, but yeah, concatenation could be one way to look at it, but essentially if you have one vector and you C bind another vector, it just creates another column next to it. But yeah. So this is one way to look at it. You create two vectors, x and y, where x is?
1, 2, 3.
Y is? Perfect. And you do a column bind of x, y to create two columns. Okay? So now you have samples that you have done run through htseq. Right? Now you have files. Supposing you're able to read those files and only get the one column for each, you can essentially create a matrix for your RNA-seq counts by C-binding all of your vectors that you read from your files. Does that make sense? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright. Okay, so this part is a little tricky. Warning you up front, just because it takes a while to get this concept in your head, but I'm sure smart people can figure it out here faster. I wasn't smart. So factors are used to represent categorical data. So first thing you want to understand is what is categorical data, right? Anybody want to take a stab at what is a categorical data?
Data with categories?
There you go. That's perfect. That's all it is. See? I knew Mo was smart. So factors are used to represent categorical data. Categorical data essentially means that it has some sort of category that is either user-defined or it comes by default, like integer or numeric. It has some category assigned to it. Now, factors can be unordered or ordered. So you can order your factors. Or they can be unordered. One could think of these factors as an integer vector where each integer has a label or a category. So let's think of a vector 1 to 10, but let's create a label for each of those objects. So let's say label for 1 is apples, label for 2 is oranges, label for 3 is strawberries. So you come up with 10 different labels, and so each, now that becomes, those labels are essentially your factors. Okay, so because they are the categories that represents of that. So you could also then think factors are specifically used by modeling functions like linear model and generalized linear model, GLM and LM. So this is a, since R was created for statistics, a big portion of statistics is categorical data analysis, where they take categories of data and try to predict or model them based on a distribution. That's essentially what modeling is. Basically, you're given something like prediction of, say, based on the fact that, you know, housing prices right now are something, based on the demographics of the population, can you predict in another neighborhood with a different demographic or similar demographic what the price of a house will be? So that is essentially where you create a model, you create like a formula, which could be of the form of y is equal to x plus m times z. This is just a simple equation, right? So if you have the value of x, you have the value of z, and then you have this m factor, you can predict the value of y, right? So, I mean, without going too much into the detail of that, factors are used for these kind of modeling. And using factors with labels is better than using integers because factors are self-describing. For example, having a variable that has values male and female is better than values of having 1 and 2, right? So that's essentially what categories are, right? So you have, you know, rather than just using 1 and 2, you can just say, you know, males and females. It's just a description of that category for that variable.
Can I ask a quick question before you go on?
Yeah.
So just, I want to understand something. C binding and R binding, do the two have to be the same data type? Do they have to be integers? Can
in a matrix, yes.
Or they both have to be the
in
same?
In a matrix, yes.
I see. So you can't have characters in one.
There is a separate data structure for that.
Oh, okay.
That's not called a matrix. It's called a data frame.
Data frame. And that's different than what
matrix.
You were talking about, factors.
Yes, that's different from factors. This is not related to factors.
I see, okay.
Well, actually, in the next slide, we'll clarify what factors is in the next slide and after. But for now, for your question, if you wanted to put together multiple different kinds of data, for example, you have counts, and you also have the, you know...
Gene names. That's it. It was just very basic.
Yeah, so if you want to put both of them as columns, and you don't want gene names to be just the row names for that one vector, you essentially want them to be in the form of a matrix, then you can do that, except it'll no longer be a matrix. It'll be something called as a data frame. So a data frame can hold different vectors of different types. Okay? So now, so for example, if you have this vector inside, see, we create, so R is notorious for creating these things inside things. So when you're stuck, start from the middle. If you want to understand something, start from the very middle on the right-hand side of the equation. Okay? That's very important. Does that make sense? Always start on the right-hand side of the equation, and then start from the brackets, the innermost brackets. Look at the two innermost brackets. These are the two innermost brackets, followed by C. Ignore everything before that. Ignore everything. What is happening in here?
Creating a object that's a vector that includes string, strings?
Yes, character vector or string vector, characters, yes, yes, no, yes, no, right? So how many elements are in there?
Five.
How many of those are yeses and how many of those are nos?
Three yes, two no.
But do we know that a priori? If we just have this vector, we don't know. All we know is that it contains five elements, right? I mean, obviously you know because you can count, but the computer doesn't know. It can't count, right? Now what happens? We assign it a factor. We call it, okay, let's call the factor on this. Then what happens?
So what that means is
it becomes
factor.
Factor creates levels, okay? So before factor, if you just type x, it'll just give you the same thing back. Yes, yes, no, yes, no. But after you've called the factor function on this, it assigns levels to this thing. While the values in there still stay the same, yes, yes, no, yes, no, it now has two levels based on the values. It automatically creates these levels for you. It's telling you that there are two levels in this. There are two kinds of attributes for this data, not attributes, two kinds of levels or two kinds of values in this vector. One value is of type no, the second value is yes. That's it. And then if you do a table on x, it'll tell you how many no's and how many yes are there. You see how in normal sense it could be very useful to have this kind of thing in statistics, right? Because like when you're doing a test, you want to know the counts, right, like this. And you want to know what categories each belong to. Okay, so that's the importance of this. Now, so no and yes, you can unclass them and it creates 2, 2, 1, 2, 1, with 1 being for no and 2 being for yes. And then the attribute levels, if you just call this as it, it gives you the two strings yes and no as their levels. I think we can, you know, we'll go over this if needed, but the basic thing to grab from here is that when you call factor, it creates levels.
And if you add another, like say maybe, that would create three levels, correct? And it would just automatically do that, you don't have to tell it anything. What if you put an integer in there? Can you do that?
When you create a vector, what will happen?
Oh yeah, no, that's right, okay. Got
to
it.
Start with the innermost. The rules apply for the innermost, and then go from the left to the outside.
Is the factor function creating a new object now of class factor?
Yes, or you'll have to try that. You have to see what class it belongs to. I believe it might be of class factor. So yes, you have converted from the vector to a factor class. We can try that out in the practical. I'm pretty sure it is.
Do you want to tell us what unclass means, or is that something later?
Unclass is just basically saying, you know, remove that class of x. You know, again, like man in just like man, you have the same thing help in R. We'll
okay.
go over all of
okay.
these. And full disclaimer, by no means do I know everything in R as well, because it's just so vast. It's very hard to know everything. So if you're ever stuck, you know, the best thing to do is just go in your R console, which will open in a second, and I'll show you how you can access help, and it's all searchable, and you can search for anything, and it'll tell you in detail what it is. One key thing is to understand how the help, what it means when it shows you the help, because that itself takes a little getting used to, but we'll go over that. Okay. The ordering of the levels can be set using the levels argument of the factor to the factor class. So yes, it is a factor class. You can use the levels argument to it, and it can be important in linear model because the first level is used as the baseline level. So if you create a linear model, the first level and the second level, the ordering matters. So supposing you wanted the level to be yes and no, not no and yes as the levels. You know, like the order of the levels, whether it's by default, it just creates no and yes, you know, based on what it finds. But you can specify in the same exact thing, you put a comma and use this levels equal to C, yes, comma, no. So then the order of the levels become yes, comma, no, as opposed to what it was earlier, which was no, comma, yes. See here, no, yes. So if you specify the levels and the order, it'll create that for you, okay? Most of you will not be using levels as much, so I wouldn't worry too much about it. This is more for later advanced usage if you decide to create or start using linear models. Again, a lot of that is done in packages for you, so again, you won't be using it almost never. I wouldn't say never, but almost never. And so, but if you do use levels, it'll be very important if you do statistical modeling of any kind, supposing you end up doing. So, missing values are denoted by NA or NAN. We covered that in the beginning. For undefined mathematical operations, is.NA. Now, is.NA is a function which literally means, is this NA or is this NAN? So essentially, you can feed that a vector or a matrix, and it'll tell you which ones are NAs and which ones are NANs. And that's just good to know and to use if you are trying to do an operation on a vector. Say I'm trying to divide a vector by something, some number. And I would rather just be like, well, if it contains any NAs, I just want to remove those NAs before I go ahead and divide it. So I'll just do a is.NA for that vector, and whatever position returns true, I'm just gonna say remove that position in my programming, which you will learn later on, but I'm just giving you the mental picture of what can be done and why it would be used. So NA values can also have a class also. So in R's, that's the whole point of object-oriented programming. Everything has a type. So NA has its own class. So there are integer NAs, there's character NAs, etc. So integer NA would be different from character NA. NaN value is also NA, but the converse is not true. So let that statement sink in. NaN is also of type NA. So think of it as a parent and child. So NA is a super. You know, super means that you're always going to include your child. The parents are always better than their children.
Is NaN not a numeric?
Huh?
NaN not a numeric?
Not a number.
Not a number?
Yeah.
And then NA contains numbers and characters.
Yes, NA can contain integers, characters, but each will have its own class. It will be an integer NA or a character NA. So NA also contains NaN. Okay. So for example, if you do is.NA, you can literally just put NA as is in there and test for is.NA. And as I was saying, it gives you a true or false because you're asking whether it is an NA, and the logical response would be yes or no, or true or false. Is.NaN gives you the same thing, response. Notice that if it is NA and you call is.NaN, it does not report true.
So you put a vector in there, could you put a matrix in there?
We can try it, yeah. But the point to notice is that is.NA, while returns true if there's an NA, it returns false if you call is.NaN. That is a point to.
So it's just string matching, and then NA also will accept NaN?
Yes.
Okay.
And then finally, is dot, in this vector, if you have is.NA, the same thing is demonstrated, that it recognizes NaN, but it removes and does not recognize NA. Okay. Data frames. Data frames are used to store tabular data. They are represented as a special type of list, where every element in the list has to have the same length. So that is enforced. Data frame, think of it as a matrix in the sense that it has the same length, but it gives you the flexibility of having different types of vectors in the same data structure. Each element of the list can be thought of as a column, and the length of each element of the list has the same number of rows. Unlike matrices, data frames can store different class objects in each column, just like lists. Okay? Matrices must have every element of the same class. We've gone over this point earlier. Data frames also have a special attribute called row.names because data frames have rows, and they also have call.names because data frames have columns. Data frames are usually created by calling read.table or read.csv. They're usually meaning that most of the times when you're creating a data frame, you're essentially reading from your location on your server or on your local directory. You're reading a file. Now, files can be comma-separated values, CSVs, which you can store from Excel. All this means is that this file is comma-separated values. So if you don't know, you can open Excel and try to store a table with a comma CSV extension, and you can then read it directly into R. So essentially, instead of being tab-separated, the separator is comma. Read.table expects your file to be tab-separated or space-separated, which means that between one column and the next column, if you were to open your Excel sheet in a notepad, it will have space. If you open that thing in a notepad for CSV, it'll have a comma. Have you tried doing that ever? Open an Excel CSV file in a notepad? If you do, you will see that in a CSV file, there's a comma that separates two values between the one column and the next column. And it'll have a tab in case it's a normal Excel file. Okay, and a data frame can be converted into a matrix by calling data.matrix. Okay? As long as all the values are of the same class. If they can be coerced into the same class, they will be. Otherwise, NAs will be produced as a result.
Yeah. You know what FUBAR is in military terms? Look it up.
Okay, so just let's quickly go over this, and then we have the practical after a 2 minute break. I don't want to. So you create this, as you can see, you know, two columns, foo, bar, column names, row names, each of a different type. You have the number of rows, number of columns. All right, simple. All right, simple stuff. Names, our objects have names, which is very useful for writing readable and code and self-describing objects, for example. Names of X in this case is null, but you can assign names for each of these as foo, bar, and north, and then you have foo, bar, north as the names. Okay? Next, you call them names. I mean, basically assigning names to your individual things. Okay, they're different from levels. Levels and names are different. Levels contain what kind of each, what each kind is. So if it's yes, yes, no, yes, no, then there are two kinds of data. There's yeses and nos. Whereas names are essentially just names of each individual element.
So levels are the unique names.
Yes. There would be the unique type or unique values.
Yeah.
So lists can also have names. So list A is equal to 1, B is equal to 2, C is equal to 3. So then you can use the dollar symbol to access one particular element. So X dollar A, X dollar B, X dollar C. Because the name of this list contains three elements, each one being 1, 2, and 3 with B. And to take it a step further, you could have also created a vector here, 1 colon 10, and with the C, and that could be just like then, this would be 1 to 10 here.
Can you explain what the square brackets are? Is that just row?
Where? Oh, here it's saying the second element contains the one element, and that element's value
okay,
is 2.
The number of elements.
Right. The first element of that is that. So that would be... n row is equal to 2, n col is equal to 2. I don't know why the slide got a little messed up. Anyway, let's summarize. So there are data types. That wasn't that important. That's the number of rows, the number of columns. There are different kinds of data types. You have atomic classes, numerical, which include numeric, logical, character, integer, and complex. You have vectors and lists. You have factors. You have missing values, NAs and NANs. You have data frames, which we covered our collection, like lists, they can contain different values. And you have the names, which are essentially the names of these individual. You can put names to lists, you can put names to vectors, stuff like that. Okay, so with that, we'll take a 5 minute break. And then after we come back, we'll do the practical. Okay? Try to make it quick. We're going to do the same thing, the practical. Please download the practical from the course site. It says right there, practical file for this session. Okay, so go to the website and download this file. This particular file, practical for this session. You can download it. And if you can go ahead and store this, either do a save as, save link as. That's one way to do it. Right click and go save link as under workspace or whatever folder you have. And then in GH, in my case, Bioinformatics 2, I created an R lecture folder and then just save this file here. All right, so create this file and save it there in your directory. Everybody did that? Open your page to Intro to Programming or Intro to R Programming under your course details. You should be able to find this. Are you here?
I already downloaded the text file.
Okay, great.
I just downloaded it to my local.
Okay, so in your local, just make sure it's in a folder that you recognize and you can use it later. The next thing you want to do is just change the name from .txt extension to .r. And the way you do it is you gently click on it once, and then just remove the .txt and press enter. It'll ask you, do you want to change the extension from .txt to .r? You just say use .r, okay? And then you open with, just right click on this. Does anybody know how, everybody know how to use right click? Right click and go open with and use RStudio.
Is there a way to do that terminal?
To change? Yeah, you can just go, you want to open it in terminal or? You want to open it in terminal? Yeah, I'm sure there is. So you can do RStudio.
But you can just click open and then.
I don't think it'll open.
That's okay, I can do it that way.
Oh, we had to download RStudio.
Yeah, we did practice.
Okay. We'll figure this out. There is probably a way to open RStudio from this directory. Okay. So in the meantime, just once you've renamed the file to .r, open with RStudio.
Yeah.
Let's click that. So it should open a new, that file in RStudio. It should look something like this. Does it look like this? Everybody. Does it look like this? Four tabs.
Organization is a little different.
Yeah, mine is different too. The organization is different. But I mean,
that's because I organize mine separately, and there's a way to do that if you go under, I believe, tools or options or.
Yeah, I think it's fine.
So if you go under tools and go under global options, you can choose pane layout and choose which pane you want where. So I choose my console to be the left. So, but you have four, and you can choose whichever one you want.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. I'm just giving you the option to do that. Does that make sense? Is everybody there? So you should have opened this file, nutsandbolts.r. Is everybody there?
I can't quite change it to a .r, even when I do what you did, but...
It doesn't let you?
But I can't open it in Studio. I don't know if it matters or not.
You can't open it?
I can open
it. It shouldn't matter. The only thing that'll be different is you won't get these comments and everything highlighted. You won't get a different color from it.
No, I don't have a different color yet. That's right. But I don't know how to change it to an R for some reason. My computer.
Here, what you can do is then go in your RStudio and save that file as saveas.r. So go to save as, and then you can save as with another name, little nuts and bolts underscore whatever, blah, blah, dot R. Okay? All right, so let's start with this. And then if you save as, it should change the color back into the green and you should see everything. All right, so let's go through this. It's a small practical. You can go through it on your own as well. Basically, it covers everything that we learned today. We'll try to get as much of it done by 11:30. So let's start. So assignment is zero, equal to or less than this, as said here. Can everybody see this, or is it too small?
Can you make it a little bit bigger?
I think so. I think it's too small. How do I? There you go. Is that better?
Yes.
Yeah.
Much better.
Yeah, that's better.
Much better. Okay. So, it reduces my window size, but that's okay.
So what are you doing up there when you say echo is equal to false? What does that mean?
It's just a comment. It's just a way to start a comment.
So you don't have to suppress outputs in R?
Huh?
Like you don't have to suppress outputs with like a semicolon or anything?
No.
Okay.
So these are all just ignore this part. Start from here. Assignment is equal to or this. All right, so this is the statement that we want to start with. A quick tip, I mean, if you want to execute just the statement without copy, one way to do this is to Control C or Command C, and then go into your console and press Command V, and then press Enter. All right? So that creates a variable x, right? That's one way to do it. Now, another simpler way, so just let me explain a little bit about what this is. RStudio is essentially a way for you to open multiple files and see them side by side. And this console is where everything is happening. This is your interpreter. This is where R executes your code, okay? So just by, this is this file here, this space, is just to give you like a text file where you can write your code. And then this is where the actual execution happens, right here. When you type or take this command and run it here. Now, when you run something here, it essentially calls R that you downloaded earlier in the backend. The R program, the actual R compiler interpreter is called from here. Okay? Think of this just as a pretty layout for you to do things with calling R in the backend. Now, one way, as I said, is to do this, where you select it, control command C, and go here and command V, and then press enter. The other way to run the same exact thing would be to press command and enter at the same time. So command, enter. So press command first and then press enter right when you place your cursor anywhere on that line. So you can place the cursor anywhere on this line and press command, enter.
It'll just do that line?
And it'll just do that line and move to the next line.
If I highlight a bunch of lines, will it do the same thing?
Yes, it'll do the same thing. If you can highlight a bunch of lines, it'll do the same thing. You could select any portion of this and just run it. Okay? Now, so that's just a simpler way rather than copy-pasting the whole thing, which is what I will be using. So you type here, and then whatever you want to execute, you do. So this execution, when a complete expression is entered at the prompt, it is evaluated, and the result of the if the evaluated expression is returned. So it goes line by line. So R as an interpreter, it takes your line, it runs it, it gives you the output right here. Okay? After you run that command. So we assign x to 1, we print x, and the output of print x is given to you. Okay? Or another way to get the output of x is to just type x and run that. It will give you the exact same thing. You don't have to type print x, just type x. Okay? You assign hello, the string, to message. Now this assignment means that message now contains the word hello. And you can just type message, and it prints that for you. Okay. Now, same thing. X is equal to 5. Nothing is printed. Notice nothing is printed here, because you're just creating an assignment. You're not doing anything, just assigning stuff. And then you do X, auto printing occurs, or explicit printing occurs when you type X print X 5. Anything after a hash is a comment. So this is just to write stuff so that alongside you know. This will not be executed. The hash, anything after this hash symbol is not executed.
You need two or one?
You need one. Mm-hmm. It's like two is prettier, but one is enough.
What's the difference between message that like less than dash hello versus message equals hello? Same thing.
They're the same thing.
Sorry.
Message equal to hello, message dash hello, same thing. Okay. Now, so I'll tell you this later, but these are important. These comments can be parsed by specific programs and help you create an output file. Like you can actually use these comments to create a PDF file. So that's why you put these special syntax with double hash and there's a comma before echo equal to false or echo equal to true, all that stuff. Okay, that's why it's there. But do you know LaTeX? Anybody work with LaTeX? So think of it as it's a document writing software. So you know those complex mathematical formulas, how do they get into PDF? Because you start typing on Word and it'll take forever. So LaTeX is basically a text-based format where you use programming to create this sort of document. So, but that means that everything that you type has to have a meaning. So for example, even if you want to tell comment that this is a comment or this is to be printed or not, it doesn't know the difference. So here you're trying to say that what echo is, or whether you want to, if you were to use a software that goes ahead and takes this file and converts it into another file format. Anyways, not necessary for now. So now let's go here, x10:30. All right, what is x? So you assign x10 to 30, that's exactly what happens here. Okay. Now let's go over some R objects. As we talked about, R has the 5 basic atomic classes, character, numeric, integer, complex, logical, and a vector can contain objects of the same class. So here, x is 0,5,0,6. Now let's see what happens if I try to put true in here. All right? So now what does x become? See how true got converted into 1.0. I guess that was that's the explicit default that it does. So you had 0.6 here, right? If you see X now, it's just here 0.5, 0.6. Is everybody seeing this?
right here. Is this visible?
Yeah.
This is what you have. Now what I'm trying to say is, if I just put true here, just to see what happens, right? I've changed, the explicit coercion works in a way that it gets converted into numeric 1.0. So it's no longer true. It's a, because converting 0.5 to a logical is impossible, right? The other thing that I could do would be, let's say we have C, 0.5 comma true, okay. And then I try to do as dot logical. First of all, so see what happened here?
Rounded.
It rounded it up. So this is an interesting thing that happened. If you just do C 0.5 comma true, it converts it to 0.5 and 1.0. But I thought that if you were to just explicitly try to make it logical, it's going to throw an error. But R is smart that way. What it did was, because I want to do explicit coercion, it rounds it up to 1 and then converts it into a logical.
But if that number was 100, then it would just give you an error, right?
Let's see.
0.4 gives you an error. I thought that would.
And that 0.4 gives you an error.
Yeah.
Oh no. Okay. No. Okay.
Oh.
But that doesn't make sense.
That doesn't make sense.
Should be rounded down.
Yeah. It should be rounded down. Maybe just let's say 100.
Yeah.
Huh.
What if it's zero?
And everything is going to.
Every number, I guess, is a.
Yeah. Whoa, zero,
oh,
is
zero
is
false.
So,
by default, zero is logically false. So
false.
Zero is the only one that gets false.
Where did you put minus one?
So this is
deep.
True.
So here's the thing. I mean, obviously, like I said before, it's very hard to know all these things unless you try them out,
yeah.
Right? So I do not expect this to happen. I guess there's, you know, you learn something every day. So yeah, so if you put any number other than zero, it'll just make it true.
True.
It coerces it to true. Okay, moving on. So feel free to play around with this stuff as you like. I mean, T comma F is also true and false logical. I'm just gonna go to character vectors now, line 42.
Oh, just one quick question. Do true and false have to be capital letters? Like what if they're in small letters?
That's a good question. I think it matters.
It matters, it has to be capital.
Yeah,
oh.
Because it's case sensitive. R is case sensitive. If you do true comma false, object true is not found. Okay, so yeah, that's one place it matters. So R is very case sensitive. So true is not is equal to true is not true. Okay. All right.
That's a test, right? That means is
he so
right?
Here, the other thing I can do is I can create this variable true and then assign it a value,
right, true.
Or make it into a vector of true. Actually, let's make it interesting. I call it false.
Small c, right?
Yes, you're right. So c has to be small. It can't be big C. Okay? Now, if I just click this true, its value is false. So, and if I then try true is equal to true, it's false. And notice that there's a double equal to whenever you're trying to do a test. So it's 1 equal to is assignment, 2 equal to is a test. So same way, true not equal to, the exclamation sign means not. So true not equal to true will be true. Because the value of true here is
false.
Okay? All right? Okay. So the same thing, T and F can be used as substitute shortcuts. They're accepted shortcuts for true and false. The letter, capital letter T, and capital letter F. Notice you cannot use the small t and small f. R is case sensitive. X is equal to ABC. This is a character vector. If you type X, it now becomes this. Notice if you can type the class attribute of X, it'll give you the class. You can type attributes of x to see what attributes are available. In this case, it's null. Attribute is not the same as attributes. It has to be attributes to get that. And then if you type name of x, again, it could not find the name function for this. So it'll give you an error. Basically, if it does not available, it'll give you an error. So one way to go through it is just try out stuff, and if it gives you an error, that's fine, right? 9:29, you create an integer vector. So here, x is an integer, 9 to 29. Let's correct that to what it was. And this is a complex vector. Feel free to see each class, and it'll tell you, even if you call the class for this, it'll tell you what it is, complex. Okay, so C or vector can be used. So you can create a vector like this, where you have a vector numeric length 10, and then you do x is this. It'll give you what it is actually. So which is 0, 0, 0, 0, okay? What if we, so here, I think right now is a good point to just explain to you how to use help. So in one of your tabs, you'll have environment, files, plots, packages, and help. So if you search in help on vector, it'll show you what the vector base class is. Okay, this is how you use help here. Does that make sense? Another way to use it is to go question and vector here, okay? Which will also produce the same output in this window.
So you can do question anything?
Question, yeah, you can question, you know, class. And we'll talk about class here. Question vector. So now, the way to read through this is to see what the vector is. So it gives you a description, it gives you what the base, or what is the superclass of this in here. And say as, so vector produces a vector of a given length. As.vector is a generic attempt to coerce elements into a vector mode. Is.vector returns true if x is a vector mode. Usage, vector mode is equal to whatever logical, length is equal to 0, as.vector, x mode, any is.vector. The best part I find for this is to go all the way down. I mean, sometimes I don't want to read the whole thing. And sometimes they give you, most of the time they'll give you examples here at the end of the help file. If you scroll all the way to the bottom, there are these examples. I find these examples are much more illuminating than the actual help itself. So I will just run through these examples to see what's going on, right? Okay? So it also gives you the methods for as.vector, you know, like what is the acceptable format, what is accepted, what are the default modes, what it can take, what it cannot take. Now, let's say I want to try something here. Let's say I want to put 1:10 in here, just to try it out. Now, I don't know if it'll work or not, but I'm just going to try it. So it's saying that it's an unused argument. So it expects a certain argument there, and that is 1:10 is not what it expects. All right? Can I do C 1:10? Probably not. Right? So this is just a way to create a blank vector from what it seems like. Okay? So the good thing about RStudio is that if you actually call the write something, it'll give you some help on it. So mode is equal to logical, length is equal to 0L. Those are the only two arguments that it takes. If there is no third argument, you cannot enter three things. So mode is whatever, numeric or complex or whatever you want. And then the length. Those are the only two arguments. You cannot specify the actual vector values in here.
Oh.
Yeah. Is this a placeholder? It creates a placeholder for you.
But you can't do anything with it afterwards. So what's the point?
to create a placeholder. Sometimes you just want a placeholder and you're updating, adding values as you go along. It's like you want to just declare some function and then you just want to keep adding values later.
Yeah, like if you have a for loop, it's really important to initialize.
Exactly.
Can you have a what?
For loop.
A loop. Any kind of loop.
About that.
What was it?
Or we'll get mad about that.
If you don't initialize ahead of time, yeah.
Okay.
So, anyways. So, moving on. Implicit-explicit coercion. We can see why this works. So, here, let's see this. We saw why will become 1.7. Character 1.7. Here, why becomes 1,2. So, true gets converted into 1. Here, we tried this one earlier, so this will make this into a character. Sound good? Three different kinds of coercions that were happening. Okay? Explicit coercion is when you actually want to convert it from one form to another. If you do as.numericx, it converts it into numeric from integer. As.logical, it converts into logical. As.character, it converts it into characters. Okay? Does that make sense? Moving on, ABC, as.numericx will create NAs. As.logical creates NAs, as.complex creates NAs. Some things are not possible, so it just gives you NAs there. Makes no sense. Okay, so here we start with the matrices. So, as we talked about, matrices are constructed column-wise. Matrices are constructing column-wise. So, here M is a blank matrix, contains nothing, so it says NAs. It does not default to zero. If you just specify two rows and three columns, it contains NAs by default. It does have the dimensions, because that's what you've created. Now, you can just add one value to 10 and see what happens. Everything else will still be an A, but the 1,2 value is now assigned to 10.
Oh, that's what that means.
Yeah, the row 1, column 2, 1,2. Row 1, column 2, is assigned the value 10. Okay? Okay. So, now, if you use this format, you can actually, unlike the vector class, matrices, you can call, submit a vector inside, give it the number of rows, number of columns, and it'll create a matrix like that for you. So, see how it was now 1,1,2,3,4,5,6. This, supposing I submit 1,6, will this execute if I have three rows and three columns instead of two rows and three columns? What will happen if I do this? So it was 2,3. I made this 3,3. What will happen?
Zeros at the end.
Give you an error.
Let's see. It won't give me an error, first of all. So what's in the matrix now? You say it's zeros?
The last column.
In the last?
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, it starts from the beginning.
Interesting, right? Okay.
That's weird.
Will it doesn't throw you an error or anything? Or
no.
Probably so it'll let you just hang yourself.
Yep.
Pay
if you want to pay, get MATLAB. In R, there are certain things that are, you know, you just have to kind of get used to it, that it'll just basically not be as polished for certain things. And most of that comes from the fact that the syntax was defined early on, and it's just users like you and me, we sat down, we decided, all right, well, this is what it's going to do. It doesn't make sense, but that's what it does. Right? Because it makes no sense that if you put two, instead of two rows, if you put three rows, then it just repeats the last column from the first one. It makes no sense at all. But that's what it does.
Well, it's just a loop, right? It goes through it
again. Yeah, it goes through it again.
So if you did four, do you repeat the whole thing? Question.
importantly, it doesn't tell you it did that. So you could totally think you didn't screw up, but you did.
So it starts again, 5, 6, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Just, so it loops it.
But I mean, it makes no sense, right? Because you're saying I only want 6 elements.
Yeah.
1, 2, 6. 1, 2, 6 translates to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Why would it do that? It's just the way the function is written, okay? So something to be mindful of when you're, you know, working with R is not to assume stuff, just like, you know, either search in help or Google it yourself. Okay.
Can MATLAB do all the same things that R can do? Or
pretty much, yeah.
Really?
Most of them.
It seems like most people use R that I've seen.
Yeah, because R is free. MATLAB is paid. So, anyways, 1 to 10, M is 1 colon 10 as a vector. You assign it dimensions of 2 colon 5. And then, boom, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now let's try something else. Let's make it 3 colon 5. Now it gives an error.
Now it gives you an error.
Wow.
I think because 1 through 6, the one above, you're not really saying you want 6 elements. You're not explicitly saying that.
You're right. You're just saying use the numbers 1 to 6.
1 through 6 and fill in the
matrix.
Here you're saying it's only 10 elements.
Mm-hmm. You're first defining the elements as 1 to 10.
Yeah.
You're creating a vector. You're assigning the space. Everything is done. And then
yeah.
you're assigning the dimensions.
Yes.
So here, your dimensions have to be exact, whereas here, you're saying, keep using numbers 1 to 6. That's all I care about. I care about 6 numbers. Okay? It's very interesting how it works, right? So, okay. So matrices, row binding and column binding, x, 1, colon, 3. X is 1, 2, 3. X is C, quotation, 1, colon, 3. So here, what is x? One empty brackets and 1, colon, 3. They're all characters. Even not a character is a character. Okay? Not a character is still a character. Nothing in between the two quotation marks is still a character. Y, 10 colon 12. This is simple, 10 colon 12. C bind, X comma Y. Ooh. So, now...
Because they're not different, they're different
right.
data types.
Right. Well, no, it's not a multiple of the length. Notice the warning is that number of rows of the result is not a multiple of the vector. It's a warning, it's not an error. It still created the matrix for you. It changed the 10, 11, 12, and 10, added an extra element for you, and it's converted everything to type character.
Okay.
Is there any doubt why this happened? We can go over it.
What is C bind? What does that return? Is it just like, it just
column binds. Binds two columns.
But should we say like Z equals column bind?
You can do that if you wanted to assign. If you just wanted to see the value of what comes out, you don't need to assign it to it.
Okay.
It'll just execute and give you the value on the console.
Okay.
It's just not going to store it somewhere.
Okay.
If you want to store it, yeah, you could say Z equal to or Z assigned to C bind X and Y. In which case, it'll just show you the warning. It didn't give you, but if you look at Z now, Z will... So it's the same data type, so to convert it into the same data type, that's what it has to do. It has to make coerce it into character. Okay, moving on. So we'll go over lists here, just a quick example. List is something that you just create with multiple data types. If you see X now, it has 4 different data types. It has 1, A, true, 4i. We can also create an empty list, which contains nothing. Of nulls, so you just specify the length of 5, so it just creates 5 elements with all nulls. Okay. Now an interesting thing to do here is to see if you can create within a list. Can you create vectors? So if I did this, what am I doing here? I changed the code a bit. So instead of just having 1, I created a vector inside here. Do you think this will work? Absolutely. So now, if you see what X is, you see the first element is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So now it becomes interesting because that means you can actually create a whole matrix in a list format. And then if you wanted to actually access each element of that, you can do, let's see what X1 is, right? So X1 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's going to get interesting. So lists are a little bit weird when it comes to their formatting. They require a particular format. So if you want to access the first entire list, you can do it with one bracket, and it'll give you all the elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It'll work with one bracket as well, okay? So that's the same. But if you want to access each element of this, you have to use two brackets to get that element, okay? So now if I go another square bracket, 3, it'll give me the third element. This is just the syntax the way it is. So does that make sense? Another thing, I don't think this will work, I just wanted to try. So yeah, because it's not named yet, if we named each element as, say, vec is equal to c, 5, and then created this list. So now I have a list, but it also, one of them is named, the vector is named here with $vec. Okay? So now instead.
Okay.
So next. Next thing what we'll do is go over just creating go over factors. So factors are used to represent categorical data, as we said. Just an example of what we did in class. If you see x, it's a factor of yes, no, yes, no, no, with two levels, no and yes. So to see the underlying representation of factors, if you do an unclass, it'll be this, which makes me want to do something else, which is, if we create x as just a simple 1:10 integer vector, and we see the class of x is integer, what happens if we do unclass x? Still stays the same. Oh, well, I guess if you unclass it, it's the underlying representation of that is just 1:10. That's how without a class it's stored as 1:10. I guess that's what it means. Okay, so here, factor x, and the important part is if you do a table. So if you do a table on anything, it just gives you, you know, the summary of what that is. So how many yeses, nos. If you have a matrix, you can do a table on that. It'll tell you what are the repeated elements in that matrix anyways. Right? So supposing we had something like x is c 1:1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 3, 3, 4, 4. Right? And then I did a table on x. It just tells me how many of each are there in general. Okay? All right. So the next thing is you can specify the levels. If you want the levels to be not the order in which you have, in this case, that means that your levels change from yes, no yes to yes no. The next part is missing values. I think I'm gonna skip that. It's just basically going over NAs. I would like you to do it on your own. More importantly, we'll cover data frames. All right, the NA part, can I skip the NAs part? It's just two lines of code. You can read through that and just do NANs on your own. Data frames, so these are important things. You have to look at them as individually as what they are. So here, bar is assigned this vector. It essentially means that it's a vector of type characters. So if you're ever confused what the actual is it logical or is it character, you just type the class of bar and it'll give you the answer. Okay, so because notice here we have TFF, so essentially we wanted to create this. If it just was TFF, it'll be illogical, but we made this into a character just by adding these quotes here. So it coerced this to become a character vector here, okay? And then similarly for foo, we can see what foo is. If you want to see the class of foo, you can have this. And then finally, x becomes a data frame of foo comma bar, which is this. All So bar got converted back into, well, actually, bar is still the off the type character. Okay, whereas foo is of type. Now let's go over an important point as to why this is important, right? Because with every lecture so far, we've tried to go over how this fits in with our analysis, right? So every time you're dealing with files, every time you're dealing with any of your columns and your, you know, your gene names or gene values, or let's say you get you do a test and the test returns your, for each gene, it returns a p-value, you will be faced with that option of, you know, can you take that p-value column out and append it to your actual data table? So for that, you have to create your own data frame. It could be that you just want to take the gene names and their p-values, right? So you cannot do that as a matrix. You have to make that as, because the gene, the, because then the p-values will get converted into characters, or it'll, you know, you have to make it a data frame or a list, right? So data frames are the most versatile data structure that is there in R. It's the most useful. You can literally write this entire data frame to a file just by using the command write.table. And it writes an entire table with all your p-values or whatever columns you have to a file. You can specify what, whether you want the column names, you can specify whether you want quotations for your values, or whether you want them tab separated, you want them comma separated, what separator you want. Say you want all your values to be separated by an alphabet, you can even do that. So all of that can be written down. So that's why it's important to learn what you can do with these powerful data structures. Yes?
If you had the p-values and the gene names, could you have a vector that where the each object was a p-value and then the name for each of those objects was the gene name? Could you put it together like that?
Yeah, you could just make it a vector, and then the names of that vector would be your gene names. It's a vector of p-values. So you don't have to have a data frame, you can just have it as that. And then you can write the vector also. You can just do a write. Or then you can convert a vector to a data frame like that, and then write that data frame to the file. So all of these will be very useful as you move along. That's the whole point. All right. So if you type this x dollar bar, if accessing any individual column can be done with this dollar operator, right? Just as we showed earlier, this dollar sign helps you individually access one column. Another way to access a column is to go x square brackets, comma, column number. It's the same as x dollar bar. So notice here we have the name of the column, so we can go dollar bar. What if we didn't have the name of the column? Then the way to access a particular column is just to put a comma first, which means that you put the comma first because it's not the rows, it's the columns. If it was the first row, you go one comma. The first column is comma one. The first row is one comma. If you want to just access the first element, you go one comma one. The second element is one comma two. If you want the first element of the second row, it's two comma one. All right? If you want the entire, that's why if you want the entire first column, it's just comma one. Entire second column is just comma two. Same way with the rows. First row, one comma, two comma is the entire second row, entire second row. And you can do a lot of stuff with just this. So for example, I have my second row, it's two comma true. Now, let's say my second column is just true and false. Supposing I wanna do a table of what is the values in this, I can just do that. Just on the second column. I just did a table on just the second column. I can also do sum. It'll give me an error because you cannot sum this. But there are all these functions available in R as part of R that we'll learn. So you're not expected to know this. We'll just learn them as we go along. Yes.
Maybe the x dollar sign bar. Mm-hmm. Does the bar get converted, like the true false, does that convert get converted into zeros and ones?
No, it's actually not true and false. Notice the bar is now converted to characters. That is why if we do a table on it, it gives me value false is 2, and then value t as 1. If it was just a logical, so let's say bar was just c t comma t comma f comma f, right? Instead of the character, then that's logicals.
Okay.
Now if we have 1, 4 and this is the database, and then if we do this, all of these are true because they're not equal to t.
Now
if you did a table,
characters are getting passed in the original example. Characters are getting passed into bar, but how could I thought that's supposed to be column number. You said
which one?
The dollar sign bar.
That's dollar bar is just a way to access that entire column. Bar.
Okay.
Because bar is the name of that column.
Oh, got it. It's the name assigned. No, okay.
It's the name. If you have a name assigned, it'll be accessed like that. If you don't have a name assigned, you have to access it with the brackets, comma, the way I just showed you. Comma 1. Square brackets, comma 1. Right? So in this case, just as an example, I've converted this from character into this. And notice if we do here the same table, x dollar bar, it gives me 2 false and 2 trues. Whereas here, the same thing is giving me the value false as to, there is 1 value as t and 1 value as true, the character, not the logical. Which is why here t and true are different. Here t and true are different because they're converted to characters. Whereas here, in this particular case, t is the same as true because they're logical, they're not characters.
So does the coercion happen based on the first value that's entered into that series?
It happens based on, actually, okay, so we can try it out.
So let's, if you have,
yeah,
then quotation in the next.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's a good point. What do you think will happen?
I think it'll all get converted into true and false.
Okay.
I'll put my characters.
No.
No, they're all getting converted to characters.
So the same thing happens. The reason for that is that it doesn't go by the order, it goes by the priority. So
okay.
Characters just get higher priority than logicals.
Okay.
Okay. So the last thing we want to do here is just go over what the end row and columns is. So it just gives you the number of columns and then the names part. The names for each of these, we just have our objects have names. We kind of come to that conclusion to right now there's no names, but if there's a vector of 3, so if you just look at x, it's just 1:3. And I can assign them the name New York, Seattle, Los Angeles. I should change this to Boston. I make that number 1. I don't like the scores this way. 1, 2, and 3. Anyways, so number 1 is Boston, number 2 is Seattle, number 3 is LA. Let's look at it as the rankings as the best cities to live in. And you have the names for them, which is Boston, Seattle, and Los Angeles. Right. Again, this is another list. Wow, this one actually has Boston. So you create LA, Boston, London. These are your, you can create a list like that. As long as you have, notice in the first list, this is a character with value 1. Here it's something else. It's the name of the list, it's an actual name. It's different. And then here you have matrices, where M is a matrix with how many rows and columns? 2 rows, 2 columns. But you're specifying the dim names of S as a list. So now M is CD as a row, as a column, then AB as the rows. Okay? That make sense? You can also specify individually what column names you want. So you can have these, and you get this. All right? That's it. Any questions so far? This is a very simple introduction to R. Please go over this practical again on your own. Try to go run through this. All of it runs. There are no errors. Play around a bit. See if you can, come up with some, learn some new things about this. And next time, we'll be studying, in the next lecture, Srinjoy will be talking about control structures and a little bit about loops and how the flow of the program works. Right? In the meantime, if you have any difficulty or anything, feel free to email me. Okay.
So now if we close our studio, does it save all this stuff or what?
So the beauty of our studio is that it'll just keep the state as is.
Oh, okay.
So you can just open it back up. You don't need to save your file. You can just go there and you're done and walk away. And when you open it, it'll be there.